So I've got the print off my PowerPoint slide, can I just email that to you?
Do you want the PowerPoint slide?
For the homework.
Print is just better.
I forgot to do it.
Well, if you forget, yeah, send, but it's much easier to file in paper form and eventually return, or not return.
Well, if you want me to, I can.
No, next time, no.
Okay. I got in the classroom, I realized it.
Do we expect anyone else to come?
I figured
Austin.
I'm not sure where Landon is. I mean, I can text him, but.
But yeah, let's send them reminders. Because we need to decide something collectively, which would be much better in their presence. Weston? London?
I have no clue where Austin is.
Who else? Daniel. How should we formulate it politely? Kim 476. Attendance is appreciated.
Oh, there they are.
Two of them. Don't mind us.
Okay, you have at least the majority.
Man, it seems like every day we have homework to
do. So, I need your. I will collect with great happiness your homeworks, but before we go too excited, you got the homework assignment completed, right?
Yes.
We do need to approve the plan for coming Thursday, and I was sending it, but what is we didn't bring up on the screen as well.
I have a stranger.
Yes, here. So do not accumulate aggressive feelings if you do not like something. Express it. We can make everyone happy. Like if some subjects do not look near and dear to your heart, you may exchange with someone else. And the main idea of these presentations, not to find some materials online, which are very rich and colorful, is to share your personal experience. Whether it is success or failure, just tell, I tried this, it did work, it didn't work. Whoever follows me, do this work. Like, I know that some of you are more proficient in Gaussian and some are more proficient in Linux. And if by some reason I exchanged, on one hand, it would push the learning curve quicker, but if you do not feel comfortable, you may look for a person who is more proficient in others, and it would serve for the benefit of the class. I do not have intention to torture anyone. I was trying to combine all material that we need in together, but feel free to talk between each other as soon as possible. If there are some discomfort, rearrange and keep me in the loop. We will cover all remaining subjects, maybe except the last one, in the lab, which will be in the special room only one time, not in the downstairs barbecue 132, QBB 132, but in the three-dimensional room.
The 3D modeling room,
yes.
Next to Berghaus's office.
Yes.
Sorry, one more time, where is that?
Second floor.
Just sit in your
lab.
Office and hear for loud voices and follow the crowd.
I think it's like two It's right next to the lecture hall on 209. This is Svetlana's office.
Classroom across your office.
Oh, okay.
Not 209, but 203.
Yeah.
We never use it, but potentially we can do it in this course. It is a special
design.
Oh,
is the one that's connected?
Oh, with computers and with three-dimensional projectors and IMAX glasses. So I don't hear any objections. It means everyone is happy. Or at least not very angry. Midnight on Wednesday, it is when I expect your slides. Why? Because it takes time, like if you come with some drive, it will take a minute to upload, a minute to browse through, and for everyone, it will delay. If I upload things before the class, then we go quickly. 3 minutes is ideal. If you're really thirsty to speak longer, you can be a little, since this year the class is not super big, you can go a little over the limits, but do not consider each of you as 1 hour lecture. We don't have time for this. Just brief overview of your success and failures. Hopefully success. Stories. Homeworks? Thank you. I'm very, please give me a little sign if
thank you.
If you were able to do it in requested 20 minutes. Okay, I need to adjust my fans. Please give me a sign if you completed it within 1 hour. Please give me a sign if it took you 2 hours.
Closer to the 1 hour side.
Okay. Okay. I'm very curious and impression. So, what were your numbers for terms in 2020?
Yeah, that's right.
Huh?
29. I might have miscounted one.
Huh?
I got 29, but I might have miscounted.
Okay. I got like just like 1 + 2 + 3 up to 7.
That's 28 because I have 35, and then you reminded me that I double counted.
Okay,
I
think when I was doing it at home, I also got something. I was intending to print new homework, but I printed only one page instead of two. So, I think it will be easier, but. And I will send the rest by email. So due in a week. And again, do not put too much efforts in homeworks. They are much less important than research projects that we are planning to do soon. So who we are. This homework is not possible to do without attending this meeting, Wednesday meeting, and probably Thursday meeting. Right now it's too early to look at. I just want to look nice and tell that I advertise homeworks a week. But it will be no reason to start. Who we are and what are we doing? The goal is to use right theory. Well, this equation maybe a few others. Put it on they're implemented in the right software and on the right hardware. Then we are completing our effort in building models and substantially the presentations that you will be doing on Thursday will be building models. And then when models are executed with software and hardware, one gets observable and compares experiments. We are doing molecular Hamiltonian, molecular Schrodinger equation, non-adiabatic dynamics. I've heard some rumors and feedback. Some homework assignments can be sued. Do not seek for second layer. if you can open handout or your worksheet notes and write a question, then it matches what is required. That's it. The report is 20 minutes. We were watching this movie. So because we want to optimize geometries, right? And we are going through procedures, what geometry optimization is. So we split it. Malkov-Hamiltonian, Schrödinger, Malkov-Schrödinger equation into parts, electronic and nuclear. And now we are working on the nuclear part. We believe that the electronic part can be solved and proved to us by someone. And last meeting, we did an effort of limiting transition from quantum case to classical case. So instead of nuclear Schrödinger equation, we do have equations of motion for positions and momentum of each ion. Each ion is considered as point charge. And right now, we do, which can be made if the mass of ion is substantially bigger than mass of electron, and nuclear momentum is not very big. So then we are given this point charges. And some people call it classical path approximation. Okay. What do we have and what are we going to do? And what are the goals? In this course, we do not wear the hat of a theorist. In this course, we just humble operators of computers with right software. But we do want to have a general idea of the algorithms that are implemented in the software. So what is going on when ions are coming, are finding their happiness by coming to a right in the atomic distance. Right now, we all know the equations, and we know where equations originate from. If you want to write a paper, research, competitive paper, equations are sufficient. Most of the science community doesn't care or care less about algorithms. We do want to have a general figure, general idea, how these equations are implemented, how are they solved, what is going on. And later on, we will be more monitoring. We will be more monitoring the process of computation. By now, here in class, which was our experience was very short, all minimalistic computations were super quick, second, 2 seconds. But you may guess that it is not always the case. And some of you do have experience in computational chemistry research, or you were exposed to it. You know that some of the jobs run for minutes, hours, days, weeks, and it disturbs the limits of human patience. So we may intervene and intermediate data and monitor how far the job is progressing. And for this purpose of monitoring how far the job is progressing, we may want to see which subsequent list of activities the code is doing. This is a goal for our meeting. List of activities for the jobs.
Well,
the format for two equations, couple equation and momentum, is very good, very general and standard. But we may convert this set of equations to an algorithm. And then I'm disclosing the plans. Today, we will try to follow this algorithm also. So each of us will pretend that I am a little computer following the algorithm. So force is gradient of potential energy surface. And we are assuming today, and maybe tomorrow, that for each interatomic positions, which can be one if it is diatomic, or hundreds if it is something more complicated, the energy as function of position is known. In traditional computational chemistry, it is recalculated. In simplification known as force field, it is tabulated, but we are not going to discuss where these forces or potential gradient of each of these forces come from. Assume that they are known. So we know the force, and we do have two equations. Well, you can plug in one into another. Make a second derivative here. When what are you going to do? Alisa wanted to come and draw some questions, right? It will be much more exciting. Just apply the first derivative to the first equation and we're ready. So right now, I'm just rewriting for you the first one. First derivative for time over function r. T equals constant function t. Now we are applying derivative to left and right part. It is d. It is letter d. That's fine. You don't understand. Constant, derivative of constant is constant.
Yeah, I didn't.
So you have rewritten the second equation. But what if we apply derivative over time to the first equation? What are you going to do? If you apply derivative once again to first derivative, what do you get? Yes.
Okay.
Let's write it down. Do you know how to write second derivative?
Yeah.
Is what you want. And if you apply derivative to function p, it is what you wanted to write.
Yep, that is exactly what I wanted.
Okay, perfect.
Cool.
Thank you. So with help of we can combine two equations into one. See, this dp over dt is already used in the second equation, right? So if we multiply both parts by m, then this second equation can be rewritten as mass dt squared equals f. And if you replace second derivative of position over time with letter a, Vanden wanted to do the super hard task.
We're going to see his math minor at work.
Physics, actually.
Oh.
Physics major derives most important equation of physics. How do you call this equation?
Newton's second law?
Perfect. Perfect. That's a fun.
I don't know if I trust his physics major if he's questioning.
I don't remember like numbers of things.
So instead of these two equations, now we have only one, right? And this form is just to refresh our memories. Actually, the form here is much more helpful. And it is even better to have explicit gradient instead of f with d, dr, of u. We'll have a little better calligraphy on the next step. No. I'm just rewriting d. What does this equation tell us? So r is a known function of time. And I'm writing only one r because otherwise we'll get tired of writing indices.
Says that the position is going to change in time with respect to a decrease in the energy, the potential energy.
Something like this. So it gives us prediction of future. How to get from position at time t to position at time t plus delta. I know you want to, you are jealous that someone else came to have a word and wrote equations. So if you are missing any initial data, you can immediately guess it. Like initial position, initial momentum, whatever. Or write something here, please. It will be much easier for me to correct than to write it from scratch. What are you looking for? The increment. The position at time t plus delta t, if we mu the position at time t, is equals r t plus something. So position changes in time. We all are moving, our positions change in time. Integrate equation. You do. Suppose that the force are constant, and you want to solve this differential equation, you just integrate it twice. We are simple guys. We are not restricted by any limits. Then du over dr is a constant, you just reproduce it. And second, dr. R, whether r like Voronov. And then multiply by what is the single integration yields t. And second integration yields dt squared over t. Dt squared over t. Thank you. That's it. Okay. So if we are very formal, if you would be very formal and not easy, you would also write plus. Yeah.
we are speaking about finite increment. So delta t is not infinitesimal. It is something small, but not negligible. We are going to plug it into algorithm. So if I drive into an accident and trying to stop his brain, I'm not stopping immediately. I have inertia. Initial momentum keeps me driving. But then I push brake and it stops me. So it deaccelerates. Or if something is dropped under acceleration of free fall, it is goes quicker and quicker, and position also changes a square of time. This trick that Braden was very skeptical about the integration of Newton equation just as if force is a constant is applicable, yes, under limitations, on the short time. Next time, force will be different and it is more complicated thing. But on the infinitesimal time, we just integrate this one. And we assume that the potential is known. And our, again, what is our goal? Suppose that we created atomistic model of a molecule of our interest by shaking it. And then we want to find where is the minimum, where, what is the true interatomic distances for such model. Which algorithm will help us to go to the minimum? There are several, but for example, we can assume that since we are going into the world of computers, we cannot go mathematically continuously. We will go by steps. So we'll do steps by delta R increments. Delta R1, delta R2, delta R3, approaching the minimum. This kind of is beyond criticism. So I'm going to pursue this equation further, and you'll get something beneficial, but I should have a couple of figures very much related to your, yes, to your homework. So when you were doing one of the assignments of finding one line potential energy surface and explaining what is the minimum, you may have found something like this, or even something better. So when we have completed the transition from quantum nuclei to classical nuclei, to classical path approximation to classical point charges. For each interatomic distances, which can be more than one, two, and then it can be 100 dimensional space, there is a value of potential energy. If our system is in the ground filtering state, which is not always the case, but with ground electronic state, one can do a lot of interesting things. Then, depending on how we contract or expand interatomic distances, energy can increase or lower. And in the true world, we cannot assume that it is something super simple. It can be complicated multi-dimensional profile, which looks like mountains, ridges, Grand Canyons, Little Canyons, and with your chemical background, you can analyze potential energy surfaces if they are provided and tell words like global minimum for stable situation, local minimum for maybe some long living but not eternally living isotope, transition state where system doesn't live long but goes from one T situation to another. By the way, once a potential energy surface does not necessarily apply to a single mole. We never told that R1 corresponds to a mole. It can be a collection of moles. It can be a collection of reactants, then it is some mass, and then collection of products. And elongation of one of the bonds can describe the dissociation. So we heat it up, thermal, come over the transition state and go into dissociation. This is possible. And basically, if we remove lectures from 4 to 7 from the course, do not consider optimization. So there is still a value. So a professionally trained chemist can get very useful information for analysis of properties of molecules if we just scan all possible interatomic distances in our atomistic model, which can be one molecule or several molecules. Build potential energy surface and then analyze this profile based on chemical background. This is useful and this can be done. But making automatic robotic browsing among potential energy surfaces is very appetizing. And it is our goal, it is what we are going to do. Suppose we still want to characterize ground state joint. If the potential is known, if someone created and did show it to us, either in the form of nice pictures or a table, where there is 100 independent variables and then one function. We can browse through this table, look through all data, and find if there is a global minimum and tell, okay, we do minimization over this set of data and find most minimal point. This will be our minimum, our optimal geometry. So if the potential energy surface is predominantly known, then we just sort. And sorting is a standard algorithm in any computer system. We can recall it, but it is already available. In your practical life, you can Excel sorts in ascending or descending order. You just get this data and then sort. That's it. It will be geometry optimization. Why do we waste time then? Why don't we tell, hey, give me the potential energy surface and I will plug it into Excel and sort order and find minimal geometry? Are there any challenges? It is a challenge, and in amorphous materials or isomers, there are more than one minima of the same degenerate energy. It is a challenge, but it is a scientific. But what is the computational challenge? Yes. How many degrees of freedom do we have? Since we are going into world of computation instead of continuous functions and radicals like sine, square, we are going to have only data points and grid points. So when interatomic distances are contracted or elongated, we cannot take any arbitrary ones. We discretize them, set grid points, and then find value in each grid point. So if you have hydrogen molecule, and we decided we are very simple, non-demanding, we are not caring for high precision, like 10 grid points per degree of freedom is fine. And for me, it will be much easier to go through this slide, this number 10. 10 points, rebuild potential energy surface of 10 points, and find what is the minimum. No problem. If you have water, 3 interatomic distances, 10 degrees of 10 grid points for each of them, and when one point is 1 degree of freedom is changing, other grid points are fixed. When another is changed, another are fixed. So through this logic to scan and find for potential energies, so it's for simple water molecule with very humble spacing of grid points, we need 1,000 points. 1,000 points are not a problem. 1,000 point tables, a range, sure. Acetone. Number of nuclear degrees of freedom, number of degrees of freedom for n atoms is Coase taken statistically for thermodynamics or something like
that. A nonlinear atom is?
Yes.
3n minus 6.
Right? So, why 3n minus 6? Because for each atom, we have 3 Cartesian projections, and minus 6 because we have rotations and translations. So 3 angles of rotations and 3 directions of translation. If the n goes to 1,000, you can skip this minus 6. So acetone, 4. 4 times 3 minus 6, 6 numbers to specify geometry of acetone. And it is only an example. We all know how acetylene is shaped out, but if we came from different planets with different elements and we want to optimize and fine tune it, we have 6 parameters, 10 grid points per each, million points. So, table of million records, place it into your Excel and whatever. Very noble task. Your computer will say thank you and put the fan on, but it is possible. But now I'm not telling about drinkable ethanol. I'm talking about the poisonous methanol. How many? I may have miscounted. 4, 5, 6.
Worse than.
So I even simplified things. So 6 times 3, 18, minus 6, 12. So 10 to the 12th, I'm tired to do it. You see, it is a little too challenging for Excel to sort such thing on one hand. And on another one, if we recall back that the values of potential at each interatomic distance sometimes is not provided from tables. You need to run a job and recompute energy at each geometry, which can take a second or a minute. But if you multiply the second minute by numbers like this, it will be prohibitively expensive. So we do have objective challenge that on one hand, knowing potential energy surface is immediately gives us all knowledge about possible reaction paths and stable configurations, which would be cool. But for realistic models, for more than handful of atoms, it is too expensive, even just to sort out and find meaning. And browse and plot really a challenge. So what is our way out? How can we simplify our life? Not me, everyone. You know, it was done years ago, and it is in the code. But suppose it is not done. Please give your creative ideas. How to bypass this computational challenge? So we do have potential energy surface, which means I have drawn an ugly monkey, and I want to find the right joint. How do I go from one position to another? You have seen it working on the movie. Just and comes to the middle. What is the path? How does it find the minimal joint? And even without, let's not think, without designing anything, just observing. So instead of browsing all possible elongations, the molecule somehow finds minimal geometry relatively quick. So instead of scanning through all possible points in this configuration space, all points on this ridges of potential energy surface, it finds the path. I want to record it. Instead of scanning all configurations, shortest path. So R initial R n minus 1 R optimal. So we do path. Well, the algorithm do path. How do they do?
Does it just look at like one, I guess, dimension in this case at a time so that you don't have the issue of basically everything just exponentiating and getting ridiculously huge really fast?
It's a good idea, but we can do even better.
Calculates the direction of the gradient and goes in the opposite direction.
Huh? Please give me a sign if you disagree or you didn't hear what Braden told you. Do you hear? Can you repeat it, please? And I will take reference after you because I like your idea very much. I'm ready.
Calculate the gradient of the potential energy surface and then go in the opposite direction to that.
I agree. I want to add my name as well. So the challenge, if we are hearing this idea for the first time, is to get an idea of what is gradient. And we are doing all practical examples here, not just one dimension, but we should understand that we have many dimensions. So what is gradient? Perfect, perfect. Thank you. Gradient is multidimensional derivative. Like in weather forecasts sometimes, like there is a gradient of temperatures telling like here is cool and in Minnesota is hot. If you go from here to Minnesota, probably you warm up. Oh. So in three dimensions, this multi-dimensional variable is three-dimensional vector. It shows direction. Gradient shows direction. If you gradient of U. I'm going to give you an example only in three dimensions. Otherwise, I'm going to be tired. So the gradient of function of U of three dimensions will be T U dx, T U dy, T U dz. So vector of three components, each of which is derived along appropriate direction. So if we out loud and straight. Suppose we do have initial geometry. Suppose we can compute gradient of potential in the vicinity of this point. Algorithmically, mathematically, it means that we need to offset from our point just by very small elongation of each coordinate. We go a little bit to the left, a little bit to the up, a little bit backwards, and look for this multidimensional derivative, right? As soon as the multidimensional derivative is ready, we can select these projections along each dimension and go along each of the direction a little bit. The larger distance, the bigger is the derivative. So change of each coordinate the larger the gradient is. Projection of gradient. Is minus. Delta x proportional to minus delta u divided by delta x. This is idea, the idea expressed by Brayden. And we want to practice this idea further and put it into the algorithm. Don't worry, it has the equation which we derived all together. So it is solution of Newton equation and it works only for short times, delta t. So this r t and r zero, it means you can reformulate it instead of this distance r delta r delta r equals r t minus r zero equals this thing inertia plus idea by Brayden. So if you move in the direction r is minus sine, the larger distance, the bigger is the derivative. Now we do see here two parameters, t and gamma. The story is much more complicated, but we want to wrap up. Recently it was 11:49, and we do not want to spend much time. we can use procedure very similar to molecular dynamics, to numerical propagation of the Newton equation. And we just put delta t as a parameter. So if we select time increment small enough, this change of the position in the direction of incline of the potential surface, we will go by small steps. Good? No objections. What makes us unhappy? Inertia. We do not want inertia because we are not doing dynamics. We do not want to have any momentum at any time. We just want to peacefully go down here, not accumulating kinetic energy. One hand. Another hand, there is a danger that if the gradient is high enough, and gradient will be high enough, for example, atoms are bumping into each other very close. And if we go into the direction opposite to gradient, we will go too far away, and we immediately break the model. We will be able to practice it during the course. If you do reckless optimization, it often leads to explosion of a model. But to avoid it, you can select this t or delta t parameter small enough, and then it continuously optimizes. In advanced algorithms, all parameters are chosen simple and nature, and we do not know about them. But we are getting general idea. And friction needs to be included as an additional term. But we can use a parameter that will smaller than one, that will do the same function as this delta t. We'll make the increment of position in direction of gradient a little smaller than it needs to be. It is a practical thing for quicker finding of the minimum. So today we will be here a little longer, not much, but it will take maybe minutes more. Do you have any urgent things to give you a sign if you need to move urgently? No? So you allow me to speak a little longer. You will participate in the activity and you will like it, I promise. So my goal is to make each of you a little computer that practices optimization. We need to set up an algorithm along this line. So go into the direction opposite of the gradient, step by step. Therefore, the equations need to be recast from mathematical form into the form of finite differences. Who is not happy with the word finite differences? Differences? Right. It means that instead of continuous mathematical function, continuous values of position, we discretize specific values of position, specific discretized value of potential. Then if you need the derivative, we need increment of the potential, subsequent minus previous, and we need increment of the position. And then this will be delta u divided by delta r, it will be our derivative, our gradient in finite differences. And we do have it in one dimension, otherwise we will die. So the increment of position in our algorithm will be computed as this finite differences gradient times delta t squared, where delta t is parameter, we choose small enough, and some quasi-dynamic. Okay? So what is our goal? Is to practice solution of this infinitesimal, well, to propagate this infinitesimal solution of Newton's equation for many time steps. To go from time step I to I plus one. Good. Last time to object to ask questions. Sure. Do you have chances? Still. You already heard a joke about the programmer in the bathtub. I don't need to repeat it. Lift hands if I didn't tell this joke in the presence of you. It will delay our time, but you will not regret. So a programmer works on a company, for a company, and suddenly stops coming to a job. Day, two, three, and administration starts to worry and sends a team to his house to check what is going on. They break in and find him alive, but cold and blue in a bathtub, looking on the shampoo bottle, apply to hair, rinse, and repeat. It is how computer programs work. So we are going to repeat this equation again and again with feedback from outcome from previous step to the next step. And based on this joke, we have a question: when our team will break into our tub and stop us from doing it. So how long should we repeat the procedure? When should we stop? Any idea? It's natural, it's not challenging. Yes, excellent. We are doing everything in finite difference. We are doing everything computational in digital numbers. So we will never get to zero. But we will get very small numbers, like 10 to the minus 15. So we may set up a criterion of practical zero, numerical zero. So if the gradient becomes as good as zero with precision up to like third digit, we stop. Or if we are simple guys, we can do this if it will be as zero as 0.1, we also stop to make it shorter. Or we can do, like, if the algorithm work longer than 10 steps, we stop. So we should make a condition to stop the cycle. Okay? Best part of today, because you will not regret. If you decide to quit with physics, chemistry, engineering, and decide to go to computer science, you will discover that not all people in computer science write programs. Some of them just do strategic thinking of how to organize programs and do nothing else. So instead of practical programming, there is strategic programming. When you design algorithms and do not care how your subordinates will implement it. So you know that programming languages are human languages. If you know one language, it doesn't mean that you understand another. But there are common Latin or common symbolic hieroglyph that is understandable for any programmer. So flowcharts. Because, in fact, all activities that we program in the computer are very trivial and simple. Just read, write, do mathematical operations, go to the next step, and do some conditions. If conditions fulfilled, you do one thing, four. If not, another. That's it. And this flow chart for strategic programming can be denoted with pictograms. Something with data going from one step to another, arrow, natural. Math operation may be square block and forking diamond. Right? So this diamond is needed to save the programmer from the bug. it is working right condition to keep the cycle or stop. So we do need to solve this discrete wave of Newton's equation because of, you forgive me if I speed up. The intention was that I do empty blocks and each of you comes on the field.
Oh no.
I felt the pain.
So, but you'll have chance. We'll go through such strategic algorithms again and again for several instances in the course. So, we do, so it is idea of Alyssa. Gradient or just change in potential energy surface between previous and subsequent step should be smaller than tolerance limit, which we can set some small number, but non-zero, practical zero. So everything ends, and then we report to the geometry. The position is whatever we got. Last is our optimal position. And minimal energy is whatever was the last value. What is before? We are starting with geometry. Tolerance, epsilon, and step size, wt. And then we need a procedure, a subroutine for computing potential energy for each interatomic distance that we can do for our initial position, first time. You can do another diamond, like later, if you do it more than 10 times, you just report favor and you know. With this molecule anymore. So, number of steps is less than 10. We practice this equation. So, we compute increment of position according to gradient and this delta t squared, this minus sign according to gradient. Then we set up position at a subsequent step, which is equal to position at the previous step plus this increment. Okay? Good. Now, we do compute the new value of potential surface at new point. And then we compare this new potential value with old potential and see if by chance they do not differ or differ by a small number, done. If not, we repeat the procedure. We do another increment, we recompute new position, new potential, and check whether it matches the condition of termination. And we repeat it until we either report failure or find geometry that we believe is optimal. Okay? No questions. You believe in it. We want to do it. So, to simplify our life, we will do a very stupid and fake assignment. We will find a minimum of parabola u equals r squared. So the minimum will be r equals zero. But you know, because you are so smart humans. A single computer doesn't know it, and by our rule of game, we are forbidden to immediately explore all potential energy surface. We do have a subroutine that will compute u equals r squared function for each discrete number. So we are going to look on the parabola. We will start somewhere aside, and we need to develop such steps that they will go to the minimum quick enough. Okay, so which values of delta t we are going to select? So delta t will be square root of 2. The epsilon will be 0.3. Function will be u squared. And initial position is minus 5. So if the algorithm is clear for you, please go forward and fill the table step by step. If it is not quite clear, I will start doing it myself, and then we'll ask for helpers when I get tired.
Minus 5, epsilon, minus 3, and delta t squared.
So, potential of the minus 5 will be 25, right? Delta u is too early. I cannot do it in the first line. So, I need to assume that at step 1, I will just go by it is another initial condition. So the first step needs to be guessed. So I did first delta r equals 1. So from now on, the algorithm can be done. So in the step number 1, value of potential minus 4 squared will be 16. Delta u will be current present minus previous. 16 minus 20. How much? Minus 9. Delta u divided by delta r will be minus 9 divided by minus 1. Or it was plus 1. Delta r was plus 1. Plus 1, plus 1 is minus. Minus 9 divided by 1 is minus 9. Delta t, square root of t. Delta t squared, 2, divided by 2, 1. Good. Now I'm practicing the one step of Newtonian solution. Let me check if you selected something for the gamma. I don't see it. Set it up, it can go too long. Let me go forward and go through. One third. Delta r, so minus, then the gradient is plus 9, oh no, minus gradient, so I do not need this minus. So 9, 1/3 from gamma, and then delta t squared divided by 2 by 1. So I do have 9 divided by 3. So we have delta r equals plus 3. So if, step 2, if delta r was equal to plus 3, the next position will be how much?
Negative 1.
Negative 1. This can't help. How would it look like? So next homework, you'll be doing the same thing for different conditions.
So,
finding.
So that's equal to 9, right?
Yes.
You're saying the position.
RTI.
Okay. So the delta is 1.
Okay, please explain what you're doing, because I'm a very slow thinker and I will not be able to follow. forward. So, okay. So you got minus 1 squared 1.
Yep.
And then your gradient.
Yeah,
you
multiply 1
minus
16.
For the,
like you got t squared over 2.
For the change in.
So we're saying delta t squared over 2.
And then after that, divided by delta r between the 2, which is positive 3.
Yeah.
So
you got, okay, so you did get
3
here. Okay.
So
then you take this position and move that much, right? So then you end up
delta
with
t and delta t.
Yeah.
So that initial one is the only one that goes
for the last one.
I'm
basically just plugging in 5. Yeah.
I mean, you don't know where it's going to go. That's why you got to
No, but like,
calculator, I guess.
Like from here to there,
yeah.
That was that.
So here I.
Yes.
But then after that, you use that one to get to the next one.
Exactly, yeah. Because that's telling you like how much you're going to move.
Okay.
And then you just.
That's it.
That's
it.
Yeah.
Thanks for repeating.
I think,
No, no. This negative
sign
is the same.
Oh, right. No, yeah. Never mind.
So, five stars. Yes. I do not recall what I did last time, but I like this number. So, 5/3. Thank you. So, on step 3, it was minus 1 plus. 5/3. Minus 1 plus minus 3 over 3 plus 5 over 3 equals how much? 2/3. Positive. 2/3. No. 2/3 squared. 4 divided by 9. Right? Do you do any mistake?
That's correct.
Yeah. Who was given strange glasses?
Please
go and continue. you agree with this?
So, okay, so yeah, I'd say 2/3. So yeah, 4 minutes.
No, okay, so it's the most
important.
So what do you do? What do you subtract?
Or no. Shit.
What this number is?
Is
your 4/9 minus 1? You have minus 5/9. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then
it is
five.
Is it clear?
So far.
Austin, you follow in the grid?
Yeah.
Okay. So how come is 1/3? So think of
-5/9. Divided by 5/3, so you flip it, times kill each other, 3 dies, and you left the 3 on 5.
Okay.
A lot of math terminology there.
Or do we're going?
Yeah.
Okay. Any objection?
Would the negative delta u over delta r be positive 1/3?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's 1. So.
Minus 1.1. Okay.
So
what was the delta u? Minus 5.1. Okay, we probably need to go over one more step. But I think we all who got through the next step. I think we are just tired. But you see that we started from minus 5, right? And now it is 2/3. Step number 4, maybe 2/3.
Minus 1/3, 3/9, 1/3,
right?
Wait, why is it negative? Because isn't it a positive
1/3? That's what I'm getting to, yeah.
So wouldn't it be 5/9?
It's negative gamma times the negative delta
U over delta R. Delta, the negative is in the delta U over delta R.
Yeah, so yeah, this should be positive then.
Delta U, negative delta U delta R itself should be positive, I think. Because since delta U is negative, delta R is positive.
Well, if you continued carefully, you see that you will see that if you slowly approach to zero, it may go to positive and negative, but it will approach. Let me scroll through things that I did.
Let's focus on after that. Delta U increases, delta R increases, so you get a negative, and it brings you back down.
Because if you had a, on the first step, it should converge. It should converge. We just didn't have enough patience, and then it matches the criterion to stop with diamond to save our programmer. And from now on, 0.054 is declared as a minimum of parabola R squared based on numerical algorithm. But now you do see how the codes are working. Okay? So when you optimize geometry, it goes through the steps. And if it goes slowly, you can just inspect intermediate output and follow if it is, how far it is from completion, what is the current value of tolerance, and maybe if you're impatient and it is already close, you can stop it and use the geometry. Output. Enough. So looking forward to see those of you who are only in class Wednesday night in Materials Modern Studio. Looking to see everyone on Thursday, looking to see everyone's presentations on Wednesday midnight, and some enthusiastic researchers will come also to the talk. Meeting is done. Thank you for staying long time, for your patience and enthusiasm, and playing in small computers.
I don't really want to go to
meeting. You think that I should try it?
Yes.
You think I should try to add more stuff?
We're thinking about it.
Should I wait until I kind of get like feedback from people like, what is he missing?
The degree you get.
Beyond that,
right. I mean, you can only go so far before you're interested in Swain.
But we're within 2% of the correct answer.
Landon, are you going to 108?
I'm probably going to go just downstairs.